Released in 1981, IBM's motivation behind the 5150 PC was simple: grab some more market shares and don't lose out against the competition. So the team around Don Estrich settled in Boca Raton, Florida, and built the 5150 from commodity parts. They were missing one important part though: the operating system. We all know how the story ultimately went. IBM turned to Bill Gates and Microsoft and had them develop Microsoft Disk Operating System MS-DOS. Little less known though is that Microsoft didn't have an operating system at the time. So today we're going to have a look at the de facto operating system standard for microcomputers of the 70s and early 80s, CPM, which was also an option for the original IBM PC. This is September, the month to honor CPM, the ancestor to DOS. I'm the Vintage Collector, and these are my stories. So when initially asked, Bill Gates told IBM to have a word with Gary Kildall of Digital Research to talk about CPM. There is many rumors though why the negotiations between Digital Research and IBM didn't come to fruition. I wasn't there myself, so I don't know what is true. But Bill Gates saw the signs. He went to license the quick and dirty operating system QDOS, which was written by Tim Patterson at Seattle Computer Products. QDOS was essentially a clone of CPM made to run on the Intel 8086 and 8088 line of CPUs. Eventually, Microsoft bought all the rights of QDOS and rebranded it MS-DOS. This was then licensed to IBM and made available as IBM DOS 1.0 and distributed along with the 5150. Meanwhile, Digital Research and IBM had come to a settlement to also include CPM with the IBM PC. Though CPM didn't really stand a chance given $280 when compared to the $80 that IBM called for IBM DOS. Plus, it arrived an entire year after the 5150's market release. The rest is history, with Microsoft having reserved the right to sublicense MS-DOS to other third-party vendors. The rise of MS-DOS was inevitable. This ultimately led to the demise of CPM. Being the de facto standard operating system for microcomputers since 1974, development of CPM essentially ended by 1983. CPM then eventually evolved into a DOS-compatible operating system, later known as DR-DOS. Today, we want to look at CPM 86 as it was originally released for the IBM PC 5150 and later the 5160 PC XT.
This is all well and good, but...
It's you again.
Why are you talking about CPM 86, as this was essentially set for failure? Nobody was ever using this.
Well, in 1981, CPM was still going strong. It was only natural to provide CPM as an operating system choice for the IBM PC, and it must have seen some popularity after all, otherwise it wouldn't have seen a re-release for the IBM PC XT in 1983.
Yeah, but...
No. Go away and let me do my video, and then we see. I didn't manage to get hold of an original CPM 86 disk set to this day. So I have to recreate the disks on my own. As usual, winworldpc.com is my source of choice to see if it actually lists differing versions of CPM 86. And so it has. There is various 1.0 releases and also the release 1.1 for the PC and PC XT. But how to create the floppy disks in the first place? I think it's easiest to create the floppy disks directly from the 5150 PC. So I'm booting off MS-DOS 6 and firing up Interlink, so I can access the disk drive on my server PC as a remote network drive. This way, I can directly transfer the disk images onto the floppy drives using IMD. So I'm creating several different ones, as winworldpc.com provides me with two variants of release 1.0 for the IBM PC, but also two variants for release 1.1 for the IBM PC XT.
Well,
What is noticeable to me is how quickly it boots, and it offers more verbosity during the startup than both IBM DOS 1.0 and 1.1. Also note the status line below, providing the current user space and the date and time information. Whereas DOS didn't support the user space, as opposed to CPM, DOS could actually do that, though it's quite limited, and the capability to show a various prompt at the bottom of the screen was only possible with DOS 2.0, which introduced ANSI.sys, and thus allowed for free screen placement of the prompt. So in order to achieve the same functionality with IBM DOS 2.0, one would need to type this cryptic line here to save the current cursor position, move the cursor to column 1 of line 25, output the date and time, then restore the previous cursor position to finally output the disk and path designation. Wordstar was the get-go word processor for the time. So I have as well recreated some floppy disks here for demonstration purposes. Both of these disks are release 3.3, which, as you can see, are identical on both CPM and DOS. Though still, you would need two different disks, either a CPM formatted one or a DOS formatted one. Speaking about disk formats, were these interchangeable between the two operating systems? Unfortunately not. Neither OS could read the other's disk format, which made it complicated to exchange data. So even when saving a WordStar file to disk on CPM, you couldn't easily access it using WordStar on DOS. I won't be looking into the data exchange options this time, however, as this will be a subject of the next episode. So we have seen already some examples where I personally have the impression that CPM was actually a bit more user-friendly. Another example where CPM, which basically was out there for 7 years already, is more advanced than DOS. Here is the disk maintenance utility, which is used for formatting floppy disks. See how we have a menuing system here, and also some good progress information along the lines. Compare this to the scarce output that IBM DOS 1.0 is providing us here instead. I didn't originally plan this for this video, though the other day I had the chance to go for a basement clearance, where I could, amongst many other things, get hold of an original IBM PC XT 5160. Now this fits perfectly to the theme of this episode. As mentioned before, IBM and Digital Research had also released an updated CPM 86 1.1 for the IBM XT. While release 1.1 also runs on the IBM PC, I couldn't let go the chance to bring the IBM XT along and trying out CPM 86. The good thing is, it boots without any hassles. The bad thing is, the hard drive now seems to be dead. When I tried the machine the first time, the drive did still work, though I heard some irregularities with the spindles already. But after bringing it home, it seems to have seen its time. Too bad, as I would have loved to install CPM 86 onto the hard file. And this concludes, almost at least, my first look into CPM and the IBM PC CPM 86 variation. I know this video arrived later than usual, which was owed to me and my family falling sick. Plus, totally unexpectedly, I could participate in a basement clearance on short notice, where I could grab this IBM PC XT. This machine, just by coincidence, supported its own distinct CPM 86 release 1.1 back in the days, so reason enough for me to hold up and add some additional scenes.
During the initial filming, the hard drive played dead on me, though on subsequent runs it did sometimes spin up, so enough for me to at least trying and getting rid of the previous MS-DOS partition and then partitioning it on CPM. Although I would, not unexpectedly, see some bad blocks on the hard file during the verification. Well, it's almost 40 years old, so what to expect after all? And then these sounds. It seems this is definite signs of bad bearings. Still, it would let me copy over all files from the floppy disk and then eventually CPM booted off the hard drive.
So I'm totally happy that I sort of got it working with the IBM XT at last. Still, I will need to have a look at the hard drive though. I don't have the best impression on its reliability and maybe I'm better off replacing it by an XT IDE adapter. I would have loved to come up with an original IBM branded CPM software kit for this episode. Luckily, there's winworldpc.com, which is invaluable when it comes of getting access to long lost vintage software that's no longer officially available. Otherwise, I could not have shown you the alternative operating system for the IBM PC. Maybe our IT landscape would look totally different today if digital research and CPM had run its course instead of Microsoft. Thanks for watching and looking forward to next time when we are going to look at the K-Pro 2 and data exchange options between CPM and DOS. Don't forget to subscribe to not miss this out. Oh, and leave me a thumbs up if you liked this video. See you next time. You're about to see some potential upcoming topics for future videos right now. Please let me know in the comments which topics you are particularly interested in. Of course, you can also drop me in some other topics you'd like me to chase down.